Lord, I lift my hands in worship as I praise your holy name. You deserve the glory and the honor. Lord, I lift my hands in worship as I praise your holy name. You are great, you do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. For you are great, you do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You deserve the glory and the honor. Lord, I lift my hands in worship as I praise your holy name. You deserve the glory and the honor. Lord, I lift my hands in worship as I praise your holy name. You are great, you do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You are great, you do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You are great, you do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You are great, you do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You deserve the glory and the honor. Lord, I lift my hands in worship as I praise your holy name. You deserve the glory and the honor. Lord, I lift my hands in worship as I praise your holy name. You are great, you do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You are great, so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you.
Amen. There is no one else like God. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. And we do serve a great God. Amen. It's just, we just got to give ourselves to him and not be so selfish within ourselves. Right now, we're going to, let's not forget, I'm going to do some announcements and we'll take some in our prayer time. But we want to thank everybody that helped last week and participated in the Easter Trunk Hop. If you have a bulletin, you'll see a picture of it. The only thing that came about last week was that we have to step it up. Brian and Sherry outdid us with the tent, okay? My gosh. But it was great. The kids had a good time. But don't worry, Sister Sherry, we got a tent yesterday. So We're ready for next year. Amen. Let's not forget services Wednesday. The children have their time, and on Sunday we have prayer over here at 10:15. And up to now, until we get a new pastor, there's no Sunday service. So keep on praying for the committee that is moving forward. And so we really gotta move up a little bit faster so that we can, so that we can't not be lazy about it. And we're not, but you know, you get the things of what you do throughout the week, and you forget, you just so. But praise God that we had some good results yesterday. We had an interview, so everything starts working quickly. So God can put a pastor here, a leader. And so remember, once we get a leader, we have to be supportive. And so we got to do our part also. Not forget, those that are on our prayer list, let's not forget, continue praying for our missionaries here, out in the fields, our military personnel, our city. Continue praying for your own work. You know, we forget that we should pray for our own, where we work, that God can use us, we can be a light to them. And let's also not forget to continue praying for Gibson Elementary, Pastor Saf Haker's parents, Cecilia Paz, Joe and Linda Placker, Benjamin Tobert, Josh Oshoa, and the rest of them, Rudy and Tammy, and Betsy's mom. She's getting a little bit more worse, what I understand. But also, let's not forget, tomorrow is, Brandon's mother-in-law's service. And let's not forget those people that are in need. And because, you know, we need, for the young people today that are out there searching, for people that are searching, like this person. I read this letter on Wednesday by a person named Waylon. I thought it was a male. I found out, too, that it could be female. So I'm going to read it to you, because this person represents a lot of people out there. And it says this. It was addressed to God from Waylon. Dear God, being happy and joyful has become a strain on me. I can't even feel joy for being the most consistent I have ever been in my life. But I can't blame anyone but myself. For where I am mentally, physically, emotionally, and spiritually, I am truly numb to everything. I do not want this anymore. I want to feel your true love, peace, joy, confidence, and correction with you. It is time to not only take my life back, but also become a part of you spiritually. I can't do this alone. I am asking for all of you help through this journey. Please, God, hear my broken heart and soul. Please, in Jesus' name, amen. That's a person. We have those blue boxes where people leave the mail, and I was doing collections. It's all part of my route, and on the last collection box, I'm collecting the mail, and this one's in the bottom. And I read, what was it? Let me read it. It was meant. So, you know, there are people out there that are searching. They know about God, but they don't know how to get there, how to get help. We're the light. We need to help them. We need to say, okay, I don't know who this person is. I might never know, but my prayer is that God help this person, Waylon. Help that, Lord, if it's there any way that you, he gets help, he seeks you, and he receives you, that I might find out. You know, only God can do this, and maybe he could write another note, dump it there, and I'll be collecting it. But if that doesn't happen, we have to pray for that person's soul, because that means there are other people out there seeking, and they know there's something wrong out there But they just, and they know it. God's in it, but they don't know how to get in there, how to get God involved in their life, how they can be have a relationship with God. So we're there for them. We're also, we're going to pray for, especially for Jennifer Brooks. I mean, her name's not Brooks, but she's married. But Brother Chris Brooks' sister, she's in very need of prayer. She's having a lot of issues that you would think she might not live that long because of her lesions and cancer. But there's God. God can do anything. And, you know, through this, maybe her husband gets closer to God. Some people that she knows, we don't know. But let us bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for everything you've given us, Lord. We thank you for our health. We thank you for our cars, our home, where we live, for the food that you give us, Father God, for the clothes that we have, Father God. But Lord, we bring our these petitions before you, Lord, before your throne in Jesus' name, Father God. We thank you for Calvary, because now through that we can come boldly into your throne room, Father God. Now we ask for all these petitions that are in this church, Father God, from our members, Father God, those that come. Lord, you know each and every situation, Father, now. We ask for those that are feeling hurt, for Brandon and his family, Father God. Lord, that you continue comforting them. But Lord, we come especially for Jennifer, Lord. She's dealt with this cancer for much of her time, Father God. And Lord, as humans, we don't see how it can happen. But Lord, we trust in you and we believe in you, God, that you do your will in her life, Father God. And Lord, if you see fit to heal her, Father God, and she can be a testimony for you. Either way, Lord, it will be a testimony for you, God. We thank you, Lord, because she knows you. And Lord, we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
He knows, he cares where you are. Right there, he sees your heart, all the hidden broken parts. Let him take you in his arms. Let him heal your wounds and scars. For he knows just where you are. He knows.
He does know. Have you ever really thought about that song? That he knows where you are. He knows everything that's going on. We might not think so, but he does. I mean, I do not know what's going on in your life and what struggles or what attacks the devil has come against you, but God knows, and He will take care of you. The devil will put thoughts in your mind that say God has forgotten about you. He doesn't want. That's why you're going through this. Don't let it. You got to remember, you're a child of God, and the devil is out there to if he can get you out of the Lord, he's going to try to move you a little bit where you start doubting. And then your faith will start going down. But you know what? You got to stand up and say, I am a child of God. I might be going through something that I don't even know why I'm going through it. But God knows, and it's to make me better for Him, to serve Him better and trust Him better. And sometimes we don't like it, but we go through the trials because God wants us to get, you know, we might be a diamond in the rough, and it depends how they get cut. Their value goes up, and God wants to cut some stuff from us, but we can't hold on. Sometimes we need to let it go. Even if we like it, we gotta say, I gotta let it go. Because God wants to use me for something. Every one of us has a calling for something or somewhere. Now we're gonna do some. We're gonna do the offering. But before we go, I'm gonna ask those. Today is not the first month, the first Sunday, right? It's the second Sunday. Well, we forgot. If you can't not this, if you can this Sunday, great. If you can't, try to remember next Sunday. Don't forget our missionaries. If you want to give for the offering, we still sponsor missionaries. You can do it when you're doing your tithes and offering. Praise God, and don't forget we have a building fund. We have forgotten about it. It's at the end of the month we'll be collecting for the building fund. So Heavenly Father, we thank you this day. We thank you for all that you blessed us financially, physically, Father God. Now Lord, all you require is just 10% of what you allow us to earn, Father God. But that 10% is greater than anything, Lord. And Lord, you said you've never seen forsaken or begging for bread, your children, Lord. And we give it to you with a whole heart, with gratefulness, Lord. We are happy to give you. Lord, I thank you for showing me this years ago. And Lord, even though there are times that it doesn't look like it's going to happen, Lord, you make a way. We thank you for those. Bless those that can give today. Bless those that desire but cannot at this moment. Give them a way to give in Jesus' name. Amen. So if you come down over here, you can leave your offering. And if Lisa's over there in the back, she has your number. If you call her, she can help you. Amen.
Presence fill this. Hallelujah. Can we raise our hands and praise God this morning? Hallelujah. It's an honor always to be in the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. We've come to this place to worship and praise the Almighty God. Hallelujah. The God that sent His Son, Jesus Christ, to the cross to die for you and me. Hallelujah. The God that sent Jesus Christ to defeat the kingdom of evil. Hallelujah. 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 Always an honor to speak the word of God. It's an honor to be back. Hallelujah. We're going to be reading this morning in the book of Matthew, chapter 11, verse 12. Hallelujah. Book of Matthew, chapter 11, verse 12. If you have it, you can signal it with an amen. Amen. And the Bible says, "And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violence take it by force." Heavenly Father, we give you thanks, God, for your word. I want to speak what you've put in my heart this morning. God, I ask that you speak, God, not me, but you have nothing to give but what you put in my heart, what your spirit asked me to talk this morning. I ask that you minister in each of our needs this morning, God. I ask, God, that you minister this morning, God. We're here to worship and praise your name, God, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. You all can be seated. Hallelujah. These words from Jesus have often perplexed theologians. I'm still doing some research. It's a verse that I've not known for a while. So, you know, you read the Bible. I grew up in church. They're perplexed about what Jesus meant with those words. When Jesus came to earth, Jesus denounced violence. One of the reasons that Jesus was not accepted by the Jews was because they thought that the Messiah was going to come to deliver them from Rome in a violent way. They thought that the Messiah was going to lead an uprising against Rome and establish his kingdom here on earth. But Jesus says, "My kingdom is not from this earth." And actually, Jesus called out violence. Actually, if you read the book of John, chapter 14, verse 27, Jesus said, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give into you, not as the world give it, I give into you. Let your heart not be troubled, nor be afraid." Jesus said he's a Jesus of peace. Amen. Jesus is a peacemaker. He came to peace. So why is Jesus in this verse calling us to violence? And actually telling us we have to be violent. We need to understand a couple of things of the Word of God once we dive in into this verse. And we need to understand that Jesus often spoke in parable. Actually, Jesus himself said that he spoke in this way so not everybody would understand him. And there are mysteries in the Bible that can only be understood or are revealed by God's Spirit by those who believe in the Scripture by faith. Now, knowing scriptures would not necessarily make a difference in your life. I remember when I was in college, I had a friend who was an atheist. He knew the scriptures more than many Christians. A lot of times, we were in a student organization. We would get into arguments. There was another Christian friend that we had, and he was basically being converted recently, not growing a church. Now, a lot of times he would cite scriptures to this atheist, and he would correct it and say, that's not what the Bible says. This is what it says. And the verse. In the Bible, it says that the scripture for some Bible is the scriptures are to be saved, for being saved. For others, it's a rock where they will stumble upon. But if we look at this verse, this is a call for violence. But not the violence that unfortunately it's common in the world today. God is not calling us to use carnal violence. The call is for us to get aggressive spiritually if we are to enter the kingdom of God. In the book of Luke, chapter 16 and verse 16, Jesus said, "The law and the prophets were until John. Since then, the kingdom of God is preached, and every man pressed into it." Amen. When we look at the scriptures and the ministry of John the Baptist, this ministry marked the birth of a new dispensation. Dispensation is the time period in the Bible where God treats. You know, we have the first dispensation where God dealt with humans directly. God dealt with Abraham. God dealt with Adam. God dealt with Noah. God dealt with Enoch, who walked with God, and God took him away. Then God, it was a time there when the sons, God dealt with Jacob, with Israel, when they went to Egypt. There was a period there of silence from God, not because God wanted to be silenced, because these children of Israel got so caught. The things they had that they forgot about that in the Bible about God. And the Bible tells us that when they were put into slavery, the Bible tells us they remembered the God of their fathers. And they cried out to the Lord, and the Lord brought Moses, called Moses. And then Moses gave the children of Israel the law that God gave him when he was in Mount Sinai. So that was another dispensation that lasted all the time of the law and the prophets. And God gave ways so people could consult God and they can come to God. But again, their hearts were far away from God. So God said, I'm not going to use priest and prophet anymore. I'm going to deal directly with the people. So what God, since the beginning, had a plan. He had a plan to save you and me from eternal death. So he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die. And then when Jesus defeated death in the cross and resurrected on the third day, Jesus said, I am leaving, but I'm not leaving you alone. My Father shall send the Holy Spirit, and he shall guide you through all truth, all justice and all truth. So now we have access to the throne of God directly through Jesus Christ. We don't have to go through a priest. And don't believe me, I believe in prophets. That's a calling. That's a ministry that has to be active in the church. But we don't have to go and consult prophets and priests anymore. We can go directly to God in Jesus' name, and we will get an answer from God. The beginning of that dispensation, of that period, it was a time where the gospel was going to be preached to all. It was the beginning of the fulfillment of God's promise to save all those who believe in him, from eternal condemnation. It opens God's promises to all who believe. If we look at the scriptures from Genesis to Revelation, there's promises. Amen. They're not open-ended promises. God has all of those promises conditioned. But those promises are for you and I. That's why we read the Old Testament, because it reveals us God. Talks about the promise. The book of John tells us about how God, we were inserted to the promise that God gave to his children. And you and I, we believe today that Jesus is the Son of God, that he came to earth and he died and he resurrected on the third day. Those promises are your promises this morning. You can take it to the bank that God will fulfill his promises in you. God, during this opening, God promises Holy Spirit to believers. It's been testified in the book of Joel. His promises that God gave us. We have God's Holy Spirit today with us, that he guides us to all truth. Amen. God opened his kingdom and invited all who had to enter. Jesus actually spoke with this in a parable. He said he had a wedding. It was a man who did a wedding, invited all the guests. The guests didn't show up, and he told his servants, go out and get everyone that wants to come in to my wedding. It's this God, Jesus telling him, I'm opening my kingdom to everybody that wants to enter. Not that ever close. We were the ones who rejected God. When men sinned, they rejected God. They distanced themselves from God. God did not distance themselves from man. And through the history of the humankind, since the beginning until now, there's people that praise God. God has revealed to people. God told this to the children of Israel during the time of the law. He told them, you think you're the only ones who praise me on earth? You do not know that in all earth, there's people that call upon my name? It seems like we've got a little bit off subject, but we're not. I'm doing my introduction here. I'm going to bring it back. This God's opening in the kingdom of God for those who want to enter, believe in Jesus. This is a promise of life, eternal life. It's a promise of healing, promise of restoration. Through this God, through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, gives the church their authority that man lost in the Garden of Eden. Now, when God created, and I've said this before, when God created creation, he gave man authority over creation. When man sinned, man lost or gave away this authority. So this authority, when Jesus died, the Bible reveals to us in the cross, the day, that Saturday, he did not rest, the Bible said. He went to Hades to take the keys of death, the keys of creation, of authority from the hands of the devil, telling him, I have defeated you in the cross. You're not no longer in control. Now God is in control. Not that he ever lost, but what us humans, what we delegated that God gave us, we gave it away. God took it from him, and God established a church in the day of Pentecost, and he gave back that authority to the church. And he said, in my name, in Jesus' name, you should have authority over all things, over all principalities, over life, over death. That is what God gave to church. We have that authority. The Bible tells us in the book of Romans that we are more than victorious through Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ's victory is your victory. It's my victory. Yes, amen. But we need to understand something. There is opposition. A lot of opposition. There's opposition for us, for the church to receive this promise. Actually, there's violent opposition for you to experience God's grace. There's violence being committed against you. Violence against your family, your marriage, your health, your finances. There's violence committed against the church. Spiritual violence. This is why Jesus said the kingdoms of heaven suffers violence. If you want to see God's grace in your life, if you want to experience God in your life, if you want to experience God's mercy, you cannot live a passive life. We cannot be spiritual pacifists. We need to battle for God, what God has promised us. We need to fight. Now, seems like I'm the one who's calling for violence. But the Bible tells us in the second book of Corinthians that Apostle Paul, when he writes to the church in Corinth in the 10th chapter, verse 4 and through 6, he said, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, and having in all readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Amen. Now, I believe in the Second Amendment. Don't get me wrong. But our call from God is not us to take our weapons and defend our freedoms in that violent way that way. Our call to be violent is spiritually. is to stand up against those things that are in opposition for you to receive God's promises in your life. It's to stand in opposition for the things that are trying to destroy your family, that are trying to destroy your health, that are trying to destroy your finances in a spiritual way. It is time that we stand up spiritually and we remind all the principalities that are around us, all the things, all the thoughts that the devil wants to put in our mind, that they have been defeated in the cross of Calvary, that there's nothing that is going to stop me for seeing God's promise fulfilled in my life, that there's nothing that is going to stop my family for being saved, that there's nothing that's going to stop this church, because there's promises in the scriptures and we are going to be victorious. We have to get up. We just cannot continue living in fear about things that are happening around us. I mean, if you go and you in the internet, people are saying all kind of things. Oh, Monday, what might happen? And you know, with the eclipse and all that. It seems like everything is driving people to fears. You see, we live in a situation where mental health is a concern. People are afraid. People are struggling to get good health care. People are struggling to get services. We are in a battle. There's opposition everywhere we turn. But we just cannot continue. You know, you are no weapons. We got to turn to the spiritual weapons that have been given to us, and we will be victorious. Amen. Now, what are those weapons? Well, the Bible tells us first weapon that we have is the Bible, Word of God. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 says, "For the Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirit, and the joints and marrow, and it's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart." Amen. We look at when the Bible talks about the armor, it says the Word of God is the sword. It's an offensive weapon. Sword is not a defensive weapon. It's an offensive weapon, one that you use for attacking. We have the Word of God. We need to dive into the Word of God. We need to know the Word of God. It has to be in our hearts. It has to be in our minds. God told the children of Israel, you should mention this word to your children in the morning, at noon, in the afternoon, at night, when you get up, before you go to bed. We have to know the Word of God. We can't be in this battle not know what God has promised us, what God requires from us, and the what we have in our sight. If we read the scriptures, when Jesus was tempted, he cited the word to the devil. The devil tried citing the word, but Jesus, how did Jesus fight him back? Well, the devil went into the offense with the word, but Jesus went back with the word. And he ended up with a knockout saying, well, you don't know, Satan, only your God you shall praise. When we need to know the Word of God and we need to use it, when we become weak, the Word of God is the source of our faith. What strengthens our faith? The Bible says that the faith comes from what? Hearing. Hearing what? The Word of God. We men, humans, when we talk, we can commit mistakes. A lot of times, we live in a society that it's focused on men. Praise of men, of humans. And a lot of times, the source of faith of many people are preachers, are people. And don't get me wrong, God uses people, but we're not perfect. When the source of your faith is someone that can fail, what happens when that person fails? That's why a lot of times you see this evangelist and or preachers, pastors that are great and have a lot of followers, and then they fail. A lot of those people leave church. Any of us can fail at any moment. We are in a battle. There's violence being committed against all Christians. But that's why the source of our faith is not necessarily what I'm going to tell you today. All that can help your faith, what you've read already in the scriptures. The source of your faith is in Jesus Christ and God through the Word of God. When you dive into the Word of God and God speaks to you and you get conviction about the truth and you come to know God And when you come to church, oh yeah, you're feeding your spirit, but you already have a foundation that has been established that you've had when you've read and studied and dive in into the Word of God. That's why we not necessarily have to wait for a prophet to come and tell us something. We have the Word of God. We need to know the Word of God, and we need to use it. There's promises in the Word of God from you and I, for you and I. We need to know those promises, not because I tell you, not because you hear it on the radio, not because they're being repeated every day. It's because you've read it, and the Spirit of God, through His Word, speaks to you, to your heart, and gives you strength in your time of need. And then you can use this word as an offensive weapon to attack those thoughts that come, to attack those spirit of oppression that want to oppress you, that want to prevent you from moving ahead. And it seems like in many places we put aside the word of God. Talk to many people, oh, it's so hard to understand. And they want to see movies about Jesus. And they want to read, don't get me wrong, books are good and all, but they cannot substitute the reading of the Word of God. You need to dive in into the Word of God. You need to have this at your hand if you are going to be successful in a Christian life. So when the Bible tells us that we need to get violent, we need to arise against all that opposition that prevents you a lot of times from studying the Word of God. What that means, yeah, when you want to read the Word of God, that's when you get tired. That's when somebody tries to call you. It's hard to make time. But we have to fight in our daily lives so we can get into the Word of God. Set aside time that I'm going to read, I'm going to die, I'm going to eat the Word of God so we can use it as a weapon. Another tool that we have on our hand is prayer. And I talked a couple of Sundays back about prayer. Prayer is a powerful tool of our hands. I know there's a lot of claims and saying that prayer is overrated, or a lot of people that claim to pray. You hear a lot of times all thoughts and prayers and whatnot. It seems like everybody prayer. But we need to pray, but we need to pray accordingly. How the Word of God teaches us to pray. The Bible teaches how to pray. And the Bible tells us how we should approach God with a humble and contrite heart. The prayer of the righteous is a powerful weapon in the hands of the righteous. It can change the outcome of any situation, not by our words, but by the intervention of God through His Holy Spirit. Prayer is what connects us to God. You can know the scriptures, but you want to be connected with God, you have to connect to God via prayer. Is what establishes, what it develops a relationship between you and God. And you know, prayer is not complicated. I'm not here saying that we need a PhD in theology for us to pray. I know people that pray and God listens to them. And I mean, remember when I was young, my dad pastor, some churches, a lot of some people in the church didn't even know how to read and write. But when they pray, oh, things happen. Amen. Because they discover the secret. The science of prayer. How to reach heaven in prayer. And you would, when we had prayer service, it was on Wednesdays, you would see these people, they would come to the altar and they would pray. I mean, you can kneel next to them and not say anything, but you still feel the presence of God because they knew in the spirit how to get into the throne of grace and pull God into the area where they are. The Bible tells us, an apostle teaches the church in Corinth about how to pray. And a lot of times, if you don't feel that, all you have to ask God is, God, give me your spirit. Let your spirit lead me in prayer. And the spirit would lead you in prayer. And you would feel like you're entering the throne of God. And you would feel God's presence in your life. This is not how many words I said. Jesus actually said when he was telling to the Pharisee, oh, you have long prayers that you pray in public places, but God didn't hear that prayer. Because this is not how good or how fancy words can I say. No, this is about having a connection with God. Prayer is what's going to connect you with God. It's going to open your heaven for you. It's going to have you approach the throne of grace. It's going to open the doors of heaven for you to experience God.
Prayer is a discipline. It is a discipline. As Christians, we have to be disciplined. We're in a battle. The most important thing about an army, armies have to have discipline. You know why? If you look at, I told you this before, I love history. I like reading history all my life. When you look at the history of the Romans, Roman Empire, many of the battles that they fought in what now it's called Europe, they were always outnumbered. There was this one time that most of the tribes in southern England, was called Britain at that time, rose against the Roman Empire. They won a couple of victories. And then they went into fight a battle against a small garrison of Romans. They were outnumbered 13 to 1. They were outnumbered 13 to 1. But you know what the Romans had that these tribes didn't have? Discipline in the battlefield. They had a strategy. They stuck to their strategy. They fought a disciplined battle, and they beat all the tribes. Powerful armies are not necessarily more numerous. Powerful armies are armies that are disciplined. And if you and I are going to succeed in our Christian life, we have to be disciplined as Christians. And prayer is a discipline. It's something you make time out of. It's something that you fight through. There's spiritual positions when you pray. I don't know you, but a lot of times I go to pray and then all things start popping up into the mind that I have to do tomorrow. Amen. I get all these crazy ideas that I can do at work. Amen. It's like, you know, I only get smart when I go on things to work, when I kneel down to pray. But that's not the time for me to think of that. You got to fight. You got to battle against that. You start remember, oh, I have to pay this. Oh, I should do this. But you have to fight. Discipline means that you're going to put all that aside. You're going to be strong enough. You're going to fight and say, this is my time to reach the throne of God. It's like the devil takes opposition in certain areas of your life so your mind can flounder off on things that you can do. No, we have to be disciplined if we're going to be successful. Discipline means coming to church is a discipline. Well, nowadays, you can watch your service in YouTube. You can praise God. There's a new theology. You can praise God everywhere. And you know what? That's true. But you don't go and give service to God everywhere. My house is my house. It's not God's home. Amen. And God is in my house. I've invited it to my house. But I go to his house to worship God, to give God offering, to give God time. I visit God. When you love someone, you try to reach out and visit that person. That person wants you to say with them, I love God. I come to God's house. That is discipline. Discipline means that, it seems like everybody nowadays want to do their parties and things on Sunday mornings. But guess what? I have a long-standing commitment with God on Sunday mornings. If you want me to go to your birthday or your wedding, make it any other day that it's not a Sunday morning. That's the violence that we're fighting against. And many people don't see it. And then we wonder, why God doesn't move in my life? Why God doesn't do anything on my life? Well, because we are not disciplined in our battle. You know how many times we've advanced spiritually and we get held back by things that get put in our way? And a lot of times we don't even see it. We have to be disciplined. Another tool that I'm going to talk today that it's actually this is rarely preached at church nowadays. Seems like it's almost a sin. But the Bible commands us. There's victory. It's fasting. Yes, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 17, verse 21, howbeit this kind goeth not out but by prayer and fasting. Fasting is a weapon that we have in our hands. Now, what fasting means, it's you keeping yourself from food and other things. I mean, if you say, I'm going to fast and you don't eat, I fast a lot, but not necessarily. I don't eat breakfast. I'm not a breakfast person. But that doesn't mean that I'm fasting. That means I should sit and eat breakfast. Fasting is taking a time out of the day that you are going to go with God. So it means no Facebook, no cell phone, no football, no basketball, no baseball. All those things goes away. It's time for you to pray, to be connected with God in the Bible, to be meditating in God. There's people that fast at work, but during that time, they're connected with God. A lot of times, our busy schedules push us to do that. But we have to take time. Fasting is a powerful tool in the hands of the church. And we have to make a discipline out of it. Amen. We have to make a discipline out of it. There's people that might have some health concerns. about. That's what they try to use as an excuse. But, you know, guess what? If you go to the hospital, when you go to the doctor and they want to do analysis, they tell you don't eat any or drink anything. And, I mean, I got a doctor's appointment to do my physical at 11 a.m. So the doctor doesn't care that I'm going to be not eating until 11 a.m. So if we do it for those things, we can separate times during our day. Then I say, I'm going to dedicate. That's the battle. That's how you battle in your health. That's how you battle. Nothing will hold you back. I don't know anyone that have died for fasting. I know people that have achieved victory because they fasted. Even though they medically can, they've been healed by God when they put their faith in God. We have to fight on. We have to use the tools that we have at our disposal that God has given us. There's our tools that work. And let me tell you something. You know, we're right now in the middle of Ramadan. You know, Ramadan, Muslims, they fast from sunup to sundown. Oh, they go to work. When I work at the airport in Baltimore, kind of like Ramadan, it was not the only time I got them all to get there in time. We had a 3:30 a.m. shift, so they would get there at 3 a.m. so they can eat for prepared to their fasting. And they were fast. They didn't care that they had to work in the airport walking. I mean, there were days there that I walked 6 miles in between. It can be done. And that doesn't mean that it counts as justice. It counts as justice if you do it the right way. We do it for God. In a spiritual way. So what we do, we connect with God through His Word, through prayer. We separate ourselves from the Word, from the world, and we connect with God. And here's the thing. That's a tool that we have. As a church, we have promise from God. Jesus speaking, He said, and I say unto thee, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys. I will give unto thee. This is God. Jesus speaking to the church. I will give unto thee the kingdoms, the keys of kingdoms of heaven. And whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound of heaven. And whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. This is the authority that God gave to the church. And there's violence against the church because the enemy knows the authority that we have. And how if we fight with those spiritual weapons that we've been given at our disposal, how the church can change the outcome of any situation, how the outcome in your home can change, how the outcome of this nation can change. If we stand up with spiritual violence and we say we're going to stand up against the world, we're going to fight for this generation, we're going to fight for the soul of this nation, we're going to fight for our families, we're going to fight for the one who are sick, we're going to fight for those who live in addiction. And by the power and authority that God has given the church through His Holy Spirit, we will come out victorious. We can't be living afraid anymore. We have to stand up. If you're going to be victorious, you have to get violent spiritually. If we look at what's going around us, how we're being pushed and show all the issues that we're facing. Seems that it's about to get more difficult. Seems like a lot of times we don't see the light at the end of the tunnel. But let me tell you something, we're not going to be defeated because the battle has been fought. Yeah. Jesus defeated the kingdom of evil in the cross. We have to make our minds that we're going to fight for what God has promised us. That we want to fight for what the enemy wants to steal away from you. What he wants to keep away from you. We have to fight for our families. We have to fight for our health. The Bible says God is our healer. Jesus took our diseases in the cross. And He defeated what brought diseases to earth. We have to fight. We have to fight for our finances. We have to fight for the church. All we need is an adjustment of our attitude. Get in the discipline of a Christian. Get spiritually violent. Get in the Word of God. It's time to go to prayer and connect with God. It's time for us to step away from the things that are entertaining us in the world and get time alone with God. to get strength to fight on for what God has promised you. The strength that the Spirit gives. That's how Elijah felt. He felt he was the only prophet. He had a position every place he went. He had a price on his head, and he went to a gate. And there he wished he could die. The Bible says the angel of the Lord came up and said, step up, eat. Because there's a long way that you have. And then God spoke to him. He said, you think you're the only one? There's 7,000 knees have not bent into Baal. Amen. A lot of times we feel like they're the only ones, but God has an army on this earth on a daily basis that is fighting against evil, that is praying, that is connected to God through his word. Oh, we might not be. Remember, there was a president that talked about the silent majority. Oh, we might not be in a lot big in numbers. But let me tell you this. Bigger armies are not necessarily the ones who win battles. Are there armies that are disciplined and have the right weapons? And the weapons that we have, there's nothing that can stand against them. There's nothing that can stand against the word of God. There's nothing that can stand against prayer. There's nothing that can stand against a person that is connected to God, that has the power and authority of God. The Bible talks to us in the book of Judges when God called Gideon. Oh, he came with an army, a big army, and God said, there are too many. If I'm going to do something, I'm going to do it with a few. He told him, you got to chat a few of them. He continued to tell him, keep chatting them until there were 300. And he fought against an army that it was numerous. Bible said they were sand, like sand in the shores of the sea. Oh, but God took this 300 men, and all they had was a torch. With something on top of it. And the Spirit of the Lord came unto them. And they defeated the army. We see it every time again in the Word of God. When man obeyed God's commandment. When they submit with God. When they have a connection with God. They come out victorious over the situations that they're facing. No matter what your position is, you have to stand up. You have to fight for your family. Somebody has to fight for the family. There are promises. Bible tells us, believe in God, and you and your family shall be saved. You have to grab those promises in the Word of God and go to prayer and remind the kingdom of evil that you have a promise from God. And the Bible says that heaven and earth shall pass, but God's word shall never pass. God that we serve doesn't lie. There's promises. The thing is that a lot of times, oh yeah, we know a lot of the promises, but we got to know a position that we have. We got to know what God requires from us and how we achieve these promises. In any battle, information of your enemy is important. And guess what? We have the Spirit of God who reveals all things to us. When there is no prayer, when there is no connection with God, there is no revelation. When there is no revelation, we are blind, spiritual blind. The God that I serve reveals the machinations of evils to you. A lot of times we don't listen. Right now we're praying for a young girl. My dad presented this girl at church, probably like 22 years old. God spoke to her many times. She wanted to move with Chicago with her boyfriend. God spoke to her. The God that you and I serve speaks. He said, there's death. She went to Chicago. She became pregnant, and she had some complications. Doctors say that she might not survive. They think she's brain dead. And we're praying because we have a merciful God, but God reveals. God reveals to you and I, if we are connected with God, revelation of God. I mean, we can go through history. We can go in the Word of God. We can hear testimony of how many times God has spoken to his children. Don't do this. Get out of this. There's death in this place. Don't make this move. The only thing that happens if you're connected with God. But you cannot claim, say, oh, God has forgotten about me. Oh, I didn't know this was going to happen. If you're not connected with God. The God that I serve reveals He talks. He brings things that are in the most darker place to light. And he reveals it to his children. And he tells you, pray for this, fight for this. God tells you what he's going to do. Had a friend that his children backslid. Praying. A lot of concern, a lot of worries. But you know that connection with God? God told him, don't worry, I have your children in my hand. They're going to come back. Oh, he took this to the bank. But he stayed connected with God. He fought. And you know what? Yeah, God brought. They came back. They went through difficult situations. But he was at peace because he knew that it was God working in their life. If you want God's promises in your life, you want to see through what God is going to do, you have to be connected with God. You have to have the right attitude. You have to be fighting in prayer. You have to know the God's word. You have to take time of your busy schedule to connect with God one-on-one. This is not getting pushed by on YouTube or Facebook. This is having connection directly with God, along with God, to get the strength to continue to fight on. In closing, that's why Jesus says, kingdom of heaven suffer violence. There's opposition for you to get to the kingdom of heaven. And you know, as time passes by, opposition is going to get stronger. As they continue passing laws and sin becomes more prevalent and people continue rebelling against God, it's going to become even greater, the opposition. But if we're connected with God, we have nothing to fear. Because the Bible reveals what's going to happen. And let me tell you, at the end, Jesus is going to come on that horse. He's going to defeat the armies of evil. Bible says, open his mouth and a sword will come against his mouth, out of his mouth. And he will defeat the army of evil. We don't have to be worried about our health, about tomorrow, because God already defeated death in the cross. We don't have to be worried about what happens with our finances or tomorrow, because we have promises with God that bread should not be absent in your table. We don't have to be worried about what happens in the election. Well, I'm praying for the election. I'm hoping for someone good to win. But whatever is going to happen, it's going to happen. But the church has authority over this world. We have authority to pray over the world, over these issues. There's nothing that is going to stop the church of God. There's nothing that is going to stop the Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit is still going to be manifested. God's gifts are still going to be manifested. God is going to continue healing. He's going to continue working with people until the day that he calls his church to be with him, to the day of the rapture, that the Spirit is active on earth. We are going to be victorious. Persecutions have not stopped the church. On the other hand, has made it grow. Where church is growing more in the world right now is where persecution is happening. Actually, in the so-called Christian church countries where church, it's at peril, not in the persecuted countries. We just can't get comfortable with the world. Because guess what? We have a position. And we have persecution here. Just the strategy has changed. Try saying the right thing, see if you don't get canceled. That's persecution. Now they look like you're crazy when you say you don't want to do this or you don't do that or you don't want to be part of. Now using the wrong pronouns in certain states can get you fired from a job. Refusing to wear certain things because they don't go according to your beliefs can get you fired. We are. The thing is that we're so focused on our daily lives that we're missing, we're not paying attention to what's happening in the world. And a lot of times it's like, oh, you know what, let me just go along. That's the attitude of giving in. Oh, God would understand that I had to do this because my word requires to do something that goes against the word of God. I prefer to lose that job, but I don't want to lose my salvation. I want to go to the kingdom of heaven. I want to fight for my salvation. I know that if I do it for God and his kingdom, I should come out victorious. God will not let you in embarrassment. You have to have faith in God. Now we're trying to adjust our message because all the generation have changed. You know what? Strategies change. How we, you know what doesn't change? The word of God. It doesn't change. And you know, it's like medicine. If you get an infection and they give you an antibiotic, what happens if you say, you know what, I don't want to take the whole antibiotic, I'm just going to take half? Would it have the effect? Actually, what's going to do is going to be worse, because your, what it's going to do is your body's going to get resistant to the antibiotic, then it's not going to work again in the disease that you have, whatever the infection you have. If they give you a medicine and you take it every other day, and then you go to the doctor 3 weeks later, I mean, he's going to tell you, well, you're not doing what you're supposed to do. It's the same thing with the Word of God. We just cannot pick half of the Word of God and think, oh, yeah, it won't work. It won't work. You want God in your life? You want God working in your life? You want to see God? You want to be able to pray to God like Elijah did, like Peter did? And things happen? You have to be connected with God. You have to be living the Word of God completely. You have to know God. And we're in need of those days. Where are days when people will stand up like Elijah did and say, I'm going to show who's God in Israel. And he called the prophets of Baal, said, oh, if it's God, he's going to have fire descend from heaven. If the Jehovah is God, he's going to make fire descend from heaven. That's the authority that God gave the church. But we need to be connected with God. But there's opposition this morning that is rising up against you. Got to fight off against that opposition. It's time that we stand up against that opposition and we say we're going to fight with spiritual violence. We're going to take time to pray. I was praying X amount of time. Things are getting strong. I'm going to double my prayer time. If I was reading one verse a day, I'm going to read a chapter a day. We got to get more aggressive in our focus, more discipline in our focus, and you're going to start victories coming through. If it feels like, you know, your children are ever far from church, that's why you got to double your effort and say, I'm going to get more aggressive with the spiritual weapons that you have in your hands. Pray for them. Declare God's love and victory over their life. Take time to be connected and fight for them, and you shall see God working in a way that you haven't time before. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks, God. Thanks for your word, God. Thank you, God, because this morning you're calling us, God, to battle. Oh, God, we want to enter the kingdom of heavens, God. We want to experience your grace this morning, but there's opposition, God. There's opposition in this for this church, God. There's opposition in our lives, God, that doesn't want us to experience your grace. Doesn't want us to be victorious, God. But your word, God, calls us, God, to battle, to fight, God, for the truth, for the promises that you have for us, God. I ask this morning, God, that you give us strength, God. God, there's a battle in the mind, God. We're being attacked with thoughts, God. A lot of times we get weakening, our faith gets weak for all the things that comes to our mind, God, all the news that we get, all the things that we see around us, God. And it's easy to lose focus in the middle of this ferocious battle that we're within, God. We're in. But I pray this morning, God, that you give us strength. Pray, God, this morning that your word can be a light in our way, God, in our path, so we can find the path of your will that you have for us, God. We can start seeing your God, you working in our lives, God. I pray this morning there's somebody sick here this morning, God. There's somebody that their faith is weak, God. If there's someone, God, that it's being, God, it's having, God, oh, their mind is being attacked with thoughts, God. If their heart has hardened, God, I pray this morning that your spirit minister. Oh, God, that you heal this morning, God. That you give strength, God. That you bring peace, God. In the name of Jesus, God, I ask this morning that you give us your spirit, God. That you strengthen us for this battles of the last day, God. That we, God, can testify about the glory of God. the name of Jesus. Can we stand up this morning, raise our hands, hallelujah. Let's pray for strength this morning. Let's pray for strength in our lives this morning. Let's pray for guidance. Let's pray for revelation. You know, we need God's revelation in our life. We need God to reveal himself to us. You know, a lot of times people can tell us things. There's the doubt always to come. But when it's God that is speaking to your heart, when it's God that is speaking to our lives, oh, we have that conviction that it's God that spoke. Let's pray for God to reveal those things that are in secret. Oh, they are happy, not opposition, and that maybe we're not seeing that opposition, but God knows. Let's ask God for reveal. Let's pray for God for direction. This church is about to choose a pastor. We're about to choose a pastor. We need direction from God. We need guidance for the man of God that is going to lead this church. We need to pray. We need to battle for the man of God that God has for this time for this church. We need to pray this morning. Let's pray for strength. Let's pray for strength. Bring God your needs. Oh, you gotta fight on. You gotta remember. You gotta remind hell that you are victorious. That anything that you should ask to the Father in the name of Jesus, you're gonna receive. Oh, Jesus said, ask and you shall receive. Oh, knock and the door shall open. This is the time for knocking. Knock on that door. Knock on the door of heaven this morning. Dear God, we come this morning, God. Hear our prayer this morning, God. Hear our cry this morning, God. We need you this morning. We need your healing, God. We need you working in our families, God. We need faith this morning, God. We need strength in the church, God. We need guidance. We need revelation, God. We need revelation, God. Reveal to your children, God. Oh, God, reveal to your children this morning, God. Reveal, God, speak to their heart, God. Oh, let us hear your voice this morning, God. Let her hear your voice, God. Oh, Holy Spirit of God, minister this morning. Minister this morning, God. We come to you, God. God, with an open heart, God, humble, knowing that without you we're nothing, God. Oh, we're not going to win this battle. You're not with us, God. We need your revelation, God. We need you to reveal what is in our hearts, what we have in our homes, God. What is among us, amid us, God, that is in opposition for us to receive, God, what you have for us, God. Rebuild it in our lives, God, so we can take action, God. Oh, give a spirit of prayer, God. Oh, God, move us to prayer. Move us to reading your word, God, to be connected with you, God. Minister in our lives, God. Heal, God. Oh, strengthen our faith, God, to miracles and wonders, God, to miracles and wonders, through miracles and wonders, God. In the name of Jesus, I pray. In the name of Jesus, I pray, God. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you for what you've done this morning, God. Oh, God, bring down fortresses, God. Strongholds of the enemy, God, are coming down in our minds, God, among us, in the community, God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I pray. In the name of Jesus, I declare the power of the blood of Jesus over our life this morning. Oh, there's power in the blood of Jesus. 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 There's power in the blood of Jesus this morning. There's power in the blood of Jesus. There's power in the blood of Jesus. And I proclaim that power of the blood of Jesus over our life this morning in the name of Jesus. That blood that cleanses from sin. That blood that cleanses from any sickness, God. In the name of Jesus, I pray. In the name of Jesus, I pray, God. Strengthen us this morning, God. In the name of Jesus. Can we say thank you, God? Thank you, God.